I'm telling you, things happen for a reason. Just last weekend, something happened. My daughter got this at a little antique shop in Waco, and it ties right in with a good hunting story of mine. Let's go get her done. Cowboy. Welcome back, everybody. It's Pat Lane here. Before the stories are lost. I'm telling you, when that daughter of mine come home with that hat box, it set me off. It got me to thinking. And the funny thing is how it ties right back to my book. Oh yeah, that damn Lichtenstein store. Right there, it says Lichtenstein. See that damn stuff? When we was kids, we used to call it lick 'em cleans. Yeah. But Germans started that thing way the hell back 1911, Corpus Christi, Texas. In a big department store, hell of a big deal. And I mean, that was the Macy's in Corpus Christi back in those days. You know, the biggest thing there was, you know. And we'll get to it. But in the story of my book, it's called Z-Man. It's about a fella named Gerald Zimmerman. I thought a lot of him. And Gerald Zimmerman, well, he was an operator who worked out there at that Celanese plant, Bishop, in the methanol synthesis unit. That's a sweet job for an operator. Nice and clean, they just cracking natural gas, didn't stink like formaldehyde or that plastics and stuff down there. So it was a very coveted position. Usually senior operators got there and then they retired there until they died or they retired. Well, that's where he was from. Well, him and Fred and I used to carpool together back and forth from Five Fierce all the time at work. It's 40 miles. Then Fred got himself promoted. He made supervisor. And it was just me and old Gerald. Well, one day we was going to work on Enern Towers. And back then, you know, it was 2:40 to 10:40. He just worked 8-hour shifts. And so we were going in the heat of the damn day. And it was August, end of August. It's hotter than hell. Now what got him talking about that, I don't know. But he said, you know something, Pat? I sure would like to have some fresh venison. I just looked at Gerald over there in the passenger seat of my truck. Well, Gerald, I can make that happen. He said, I hear you, old Fred. I said, you don't hear shit. Well, yeah, people say that, you know, people say whatever they want. I don't tell nobody nothing. But if you want to kill a damn big deer, get us a fresh venison, I can make it happen. Well, by golly, he says, I think I'm up to it. Gerald, you ain't never done this shit before, have you? No, he said, I'm a fast learner. I said, okay. I said, tomorrow, when we go to work, I'll bring a gun and a light with us. And when we get off work, off Enern Towers, we'll just kill us one on the way home. He said, okay. Well, next day come, I got my stuff together and put the gun in the car and the light in the car and went out there and picked old Z-Man up and said, let's go. We started going down that road once we got on 285, heading to Revere, because I knew good well that's a stretch of road I was going to hunt. And I started listening, old boy. I said, now you listen to me. This is how this goes down. Step by step. Just like in the book. I write that story, Road Hunting 101, and tell you how to do it. This is how you do it, boop, boop, where you don't get caught. And I was schooling old Z-Man up pretty good, you know. Man, he acted like he was just getting it all, you know. I said, you got this down? Yeah. You shoot, you bail with a gun. I take off with the light. I go hide the light. You get the deer, gut him, bring him to the fence. Get his horns under the fence. Back off till I come back, pick you up. I got it. I said, okay. Well, we got the plant. We went to our respective units to go to work. Had a pretty good day, and it was getting about 10 or 15 minutes before shift change, and the phone rang in the control room. One of the guys said, Pat, it's for you. Who's calling me, you know? I, Because I knew it was inside call, inside the plant, you know. It's damned old Gerald. Hey, man, are we still on for tonight? I said, man, you getting cold feet, Gerald? He said, oh, no. I just might be getting a little excited. I said, I'm looking forward to it, too, Gerald. I said, this ain't going to be no deal. You with me. I know what's going on. We're going to go get us some venison, just like you said you wanted. Okay. I said, I'll come to gate 2 and pick you up when shift changes. All right. Well, shift change, I went down there to gate and I picked him up. Boy, he was just wound up like an Energizer bunny, man. He was excited. We got down here, turned to Revere and turned on 285, head towards Falfurrias, and knew that stretch of road there is about 11 miles. We killed a lot of deer off that road right there. Just a lot of them back in the days. We'd hid that gun out where I told him that afternoon we was going to hide it right there along the fence in that deep grass. And we made one pass through that stretch of road and come back. I told him, throw the damn light out. Well, we started lighting. And I ain't kidding you. There was 4 or 5 big old bucks all right there together, man. They were all killers. They all need to be shot, you know. People said, oh, 150 hunters. I don't know what them some bitches were. They were pretty. They were big. They was out there over 20 inches. They were good deer. They needed killing and eating. And there was one of them. That some bitch was laying. He wasn't 25 yards on the other side of the fence, just laying in the grass. He looked like the biggest one to me. I told Gerald, I said, just let that light pass over him. Get it down there about a couple hundred yards. And I said, now turn that light out. Don't want to spook him. We went on down the road, made a wealthy look, make sure everything was clear. And I pulled back up there and I told him, I said, jump out there and get that damn gun. And old Gerald jumped out there and got the gun and come back. I said, what we're going to do? We're going to go right back to that spot. How are you going to remember that spot? I said, well, there's a piece of throwed rubber right there. I dropped it out my truck window. Someday I'll teach you that lesson too. We pulled up there where those deer were. Gerald had the gun across his lap there. Had that light. And I said, don't you turn that damn light on until we're ready, you know. And I said, I'm going to grab that light and let you shoot that thing. Okay. But I could see that damn piece of throwed rubber that I used to mark him deer. On the road, I knew exactly where he was. And I just idled that truck down. I just let it ease up or rolled up or stopped. And I said, throw the light on him. And that son of a bitch was still laying in the same spot. Just looking. I said, here, give me that damn light. See, I said, shit, no, bad, you shoot the bastard. I said, no, I'm going to let you kill him. He said, no, won't you shoot him. He said, I'm nervous. I'm excited. I'll miss that. You can't miss nothing 25 yards. He said, just shoot the damn deer and I'll go get it, Pat. I said, fine, I'm tired of arguing with you. Pow! Well, guys, there was zero meat on that buck bruised. Because the only thing hit the ground was his chin. Kaboom! He's already laying down. He was a good-sized buck, too. He a big buck. Last day of August. Well, old Z-Man, he bailed out the damn car with the gun just like I taught him. And I drove off. I got down there past the county line, and I hid that light out along the fence. In case somebody was to stop me or something, and I didn't have nothing, you know. I gave him some time. I didn't think it was going to take that long because Teddy was right there on top of him. It wasn't like you had to look for him or anything. He'd get tripped over him when you jumped the fence, you know. We came back by. I made that wealthy. I pulled up there to pick him up, and that Gerald Zimmer, I'm telling you, he went over that fence like a young kid. He barely hit the ground. He got a hold of them horns, and he's dragging. Now, by that time, I'm out of that truck. And I'm grabbing the horns, too, and we're dragging him in the truck. We load and go with that buck in under 10 seconds. I'm telling you, he's in the back of the damn truck, and we're in the truck, and we're gone. And I was going, man, that's pretty damn good. Old Z-Man, pretty damn good newbie. And he hit everything just right on the button. Just did exactly the way I told him. That's one reason I wrote that story about old Gerald. I never forget. He said, I'll come by tomorrow and get my meat. And I said, yeah, I'll get it quartered up and chilled out tonight, you know, and we'll split it up tomorrow. When he showed up, I said, do you want them velvet horns? I said, take it, son of a bitch. He said, I don't want that slick horn, son of a bitch. He said, kept sliding out of my hands while I was trying to drag him. And what the hell are you going to do with them damn things? I said, well, you can peel them and stain them or do something. I don't want them damn horns. I'll just take my meat. And I said, okay, Gerald, here, we split the meat up. Well, I hung him horns in the rafter of that garage. I left them a little bit too long because I got a whiff of them one day. I said, damn it, before that gets bad. And I got out there and I peeled them off. And I'm telling you, damn, them horns were hard all the way to the tip. You could have salvaged them. I'm picturing this here buck. It's turned to a last story of that buck. And the thing is about that deer, well, that picture is my icon. You see it everywhere. My Instagram, my TikTok, my YouTube, my website. It's got that picture up right there. That's Gerald's buck. Just because I killed him. But neat thing was, look at that suntan I had. Yeah, but I'm telling you, it was the last day of August. That's a big old buck. The reason I wanted to tell you about Gerald was back here with this damn hat box that my daughter got. Yeah, this Lichtenstein's hat box. Because it's in my book, too. I tell the damn story. It was about 1978, 79, 80. Hell, I don't know. I lose track of time anymore. But they had shut that store down downtown Corpus Christi, and they built another one in the Parkdale Plaza. And they had a big shop center there. And that store was torn down. That original store, Lichtenstein store, that was built in 1911. Well, bigger than Dallas. Gerald Z-Man, the man I just killed that buck with, he bought all the lumber out of that store for $5,000. And partner, there was rough cut 2x12x24 virgin redwood. That was the joists and the floor, the ceilings, the roof, everything. And he had a pile of it. He had so damn much redwood lumber, man built him a two-story house out of it. Yes, sir. There is a virgin redwood two-story house about 4 miles outside of Foul Furious, Texas. Never saw a redwood tree in its life. You can't make this kind of shit up. But there it is. There it was. I remember he got that thing built and he had some drop-offs. So I said, what are you going to do with all of them? He said, hell, I'm through. You know, I said, that thing ain't about 5-6 foot long. I said, man, I think I could make something out of that. And I took me some of them drop-offs. I run them through the planer, got them to thickness, then I ripped them all up. I ended up making a porch swing out of that virgin redwood. Oh, it was a pretty son of a buck, too. You know, and you got to understand, this wood was cut damn near turn of the century. You know, it's old. Well, that swing I built in Corpus Christi all those years ago, when I moved to Augusta, Georgia, well, it came with us. Then when the family and I moved to South Carolina, it went with us. Matter of fact, we moved back to Texas in 90, it came with us. And I kept that thing for years. I'd take it apart every year and run the thing through the planer and just skin it just enough to bring that bright color back, and I'd restain it. It finally got too thin to mess with, and I said, to hell with it. And I just built another porch swing out of something else. But there's always another purpose for things. When that little girl of mine brought that hat box home, I think she gives 60 cents for it in that damn store. I laughed. Because flood of stuff come back. Just flood stuff. Remembering them people and those guys and old Gerald. I thought a lot of him. He was a good fella. Now, I'm telling you what, fellas. I can sit here on this sofa and tell y'all stories every day from now on, and I'll never run out. But I think this in here, since, you know, hunting season's over with, deer season's over with, we're going to switch gears a little bit. Because we'll probably go to hunting and fishing and doing some other crazy shit that I'm going to tell you about. I got a lot of stories to tell. And I'm going to keep doing it right here on this YouTube channel. Keep trying to sell my book. Tell everybody, order the book now. Go to the website, order the book. Had a gentleman, I'm going to post office Mendigo, gentleman bought a 5-pack from San Antonio. And I'm going to get that in the mail to him today. He's obviously got some friends wanting to copy the book. And that tickles me. And at the end of the day, guys, you know it goes for a good cause. And that's why I do what I do. Y'all know that. But like I said, we're going to switch gears. I got one more hunting story I'm going to tell next. But it's a waterfowl hunting story. Well, I'm sure we'll do that next. And then... Oh, I've got a litany of stories I'm going to tell you about. I get people all the time writing me and commenting and saying this and that. Won't you tell about this? Won't you tell about the biggest buck you ever saw? Tell about this. But I've had 4 people now that's read my book. Because I don't go into it in my book. I don't go into that. But the reason I landed in Foul Furious, Texas in 1972 was... I was cut from one end to another, had a bunch of stitches in me. And I had an altercation in California. It's a good one too. And these people tell me, please tell us that story. Please tell us that story. Well, that's one I'm on the list too. Like I said, I got a bunch of them. And I have a lot of fun doing this. Good way to kill the day. You know, and I feel like I get closer to people all the time. People write me and say the nicest things. I don't have near the haters that Charlie did. You know, Charlie still got haters out there, but, you know. I talked to him yesterday, too. He's doing real good. He getting at that office of his is about done. Yeah, they hit it hard yesterday, and it won't be long, and he'll be shooting YouTubes and cutting podcast stuff right there in his damn own little studio. And I'm looking forward to that. Charlie and I have been friends for a long time. But, you know, he did it his way, I did it my way. We were different. But that don't mean we can't be friends, you know. You're not supposed to judge one another, you know. And I didn't, and he never judged me. So, y'all hit that like and smash and grab and sign up and do all that stuff you're supposed to do. But everybody tells me that audiobook is a piece of artwork. So if you don't like to read, just download the audiobook. And we'll catch you back on the flip.